Not long ago, I was talking in several different forums, one of them was here, I believe, about the leading of the Holy Spirit. And it's a subject that's been on my mind for some little time, and I've been, you know, like a dog kind of gnaws on a bone, I've been gnawing on the subject. I wondered how the Holy Spirit leads and how we can tell the difference between the moving of the Holy Spirit and the moving of our own lusts, our own desires, our own wants, our own fears. In other words, is the Holy Spirit telling me not to do this, or is my own fear telling me not to do it? Is the Holy Spirit leading me in this direction, or am I going that way because it's something my own ego wants me to do, or is taking me to do? How can you tell the difference? And when Luke speaks of Paul and his group who are working on their missionary journey, that the Holy Spirit forbade them to go into Asia, and when they attempted to go into Bithynia, it wouldn't permit that either. How did the Holy Spirit tell them that? Well, Luke doesn't tell us how they knew. I feel I understand this today a little better than I did before, so I hope you'll forgive me if I plow the same ground again. I've been known to do this before. I know I really don't want to shock any of you out there, but I really don't know everything. There's large gaps in my knowledge. There are areas where I know something about God and want to know a great deal more. And so one of the joys in life is to be able to talk it over with students. And we always talk it over with people who are of the same mind and also want to understand and want to grow in our knowledge and understanding. So, let's talk about the Holy Spirit and the leadership of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit seems at sometimes subtle and at other times very direct. In Acts 10, there's an interesting illustration. We usually go there looking for information or trying to deal with the question of clean and unclean meats because of the vision Peter had, having to do with clean and unclean animals. That's not what we're going there for today. We're going there for a totally different reason. In Acts 10, verse 1, it tells us that there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius. He was a centurion of the Italian band, a Roman. But he was a devout man and one that feared God with all of his house and who gave a lot of alms and prayed to God constantly. He was a regular man in prayer to God. And he saw in vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming to him and saying, Cornelius. Now, this time it's not the Holy Spirit speaking. This time, in a vision, it's an angel, a messenger, come right from God. And the angel speaks to him plainly. He gives him the message. Most of us would feel, I think, that life would be a lot simpler if we could get that kind of answer when we face the problems we face, right? Life would just be a lot simpler if I could get on my knees, pray to God about this, and 2 or 3 days of prayer for it, I would go into a vision, a man would appear to me in a vision and give me the solution to my problem. Life would just be a lot simpler. It would. But would it accomplish what God is after overall? That's the question. Now, when Cornelius looked at this angel, he was scared. And he said, what is it, Lord? And he said, well, your prayers and your alms, in other words, he had given all kinds of money to the poor. He said, your prayers and your alms have come up for a memorial before God. Now, what I want you to do this is send men to Joppa and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter. He lodges with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the seaside. He will tell you what you ought to do. When the angel that spoke to Cornelius departed, he called two of his household servants, a devout soldier, and one of them that waited on him continually. And when he had declared all these things to them, he sent them to Joppa. Now, on the morrow, while they're on their journey, working their way down to the city, Peter is going up to the housetop to pray at about the sixth hour. It's interesting, you know, the sixth hour and the ninth hour, and these are hours of prayer, and that it was customary for people to pray at certain hours of the day. These are the two common ones. While Peter was praying, he fell into a trance, and he had a vision. Now, the vision that Peter got was a kind of a softening up exercise, as it were, like you take out the old hammer and soften up your minute steak before you cook it. God was having to work on Peter's attitude. Because to tell you the truth, Peter was as narrow-minded, a bigot, relative to Gentiles, as any Jew you're ever going to find. He's just like all the rest of them. You know, the Gentiles were a different class of people. We're not supposed to eat with Gentiles. We're not supposed to have anything to do with Gentiles. And that got translated over in the church to the fact that the gospel didn't even go to Gentiles. And this is the first time where God, you know, takes in hand. He says, look, I'm going to have to somehow do a little attitude adjustment where Peter is concerned. So it starts with a vision. And in the vision, He sees a sheet come down from heaven with all kinds of animals in it. That part of it we've been through many times before. Now, in verse 17, when Peter doubted in himself what the vision he had seen should mean. Now, here it's all over. He's seen the vision. It's happened. And he's come to himself, and he's saying, I wonder what that means. The general idea of making clean and unclean meats okay to eat never crossed his mind, with good reason. I mean, he knew what the law of God was in this regard, and he knew it wasn't going to be abolished. So Peter never thought that. He did wonder what it did mean, and he is about to learn what it did mean. He said, behold, the men that were sent from Cornelius were knocking at the door and called and asked whether Simon, who was surnamed Peter, was lodged there. And while Peter was up there thinking about the vision, and I imagine he was pretty wrapped in thought, the Spirit said to him, behold, three men seek you. Get up, go down, and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. Now that's interesting, because this isn't just a vague notion that Peter gets, right? Because it's very explicit and specific. Not one, not two, but three men are downstairs. Get up, go down, go with them. How'd the Holy Spirit do this? I don't have any idea. Nobody else does. I mean, I don't know whether it formed as words in his mind. I don't know whether it sounded like, it seemed like words that he was hearing without him hearing. I don't know if the Holy Spirit actually spoke words into his ear. It's not terribly important. But what is, I think, significant is that the Holy Spirit did give him explicit instructions. However, we're going to see that the explicit instructions the Spirit gave him were not complete. They only went so far. It was, get up, there are three men downstairs, go down, go with them, and don't doubt. No further instructions as to what he was to do on this occasion. So, you know, Peter decided he better get up and go down. There was still some doubt in Peter's mind about what was going on. He didn't know. So as Peter was coming into Cornelius' house, verse 25, passing down a little bit, skipping over some parts, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. And Peter took him up and says, hold it, I'm also a man like you are. You don't need to do that. And as he talked with him, he went in and he found a whole group of people gathered together. And the first words he said were, you know that it's an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or to come unto one of another nation. But God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Finally, he understands the vision. God showed me through that sheet he let down that I should not call any man common or unclean. So now we know what the vision was all about. But we still don't know everything. Therefore, I have come to you without gainsaying as soon as I was sent for. I ask, therefore, with what intent did you send for me? Interesting question. Here I am. The Holy Spirit said, come. Nothing doubting. Get yourself on down there. He walks into a place in a house full of Gentiles, and he puts immediately together the whole question of what the sheet was about, what the story was about, that he was supposed to be in that place, and he was supposed to talk to these people. So far, that's really all Peter knows. Cornelius said, 4 days ago I was fasting until this hour. And at the ninth hour I prayed in my house, and a man stood before me in bright clothing and said, Cornelius, your prayer is heard. Your alms are held in remembrance in the sight of God. Send to Joppa, call Simon, whose surname is Peter. He's in the house of Simon a tanner by the seaside, who, when he comes, shall speak to you. So I sent, and you have done well that you came. And now here we are all present before God to hear the things, all things that are commanded to you of God. And so Peter realizes that the Holy Spirit has led him to this place to speak to these people. The Holy Spirit was explicit on the first part of it, but it was the circumstances following that clarified the issue as to what it was he was there for. And he still doesn't know completely where it's going. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, now this is an odd expression. How do you speak without opening your mouth? You know, you kind of wonder why those words are there. It appears to be an idiomatic expression. Commentary suggests that it is an idiom for introducing a weighty statement. You know, instead of just saying, he said, because this is an important statement, he opened his mouth. Anne said. That may well be what it is. What wonders if the sense of it is close to our concept of speaking from the heart. In other words, this is a special occasion that Peter opened his heart and spoke to these people on this occasion. So he said, "Of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons, but has in every nation him that fears him and works righteousness and is accepted with him." It isn't just a Jewish thing we're dealing with here. And you know, the whole book of Acts is about this. It's about the breakout of the faith of God, the worship of God, from being essentially what was at that time a Jewish religion, to taking God to the world, to the nations. God was not satisfied with being the God of the Jews. He was the God of all men. And the time had come to make a breakout on that issue. And so here was Peter having the initial experience of approaching the Gentiles. He says, in every nation he has those that fear him and work righteousness and are accepted with him. The word which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus, he is Lord of all. And then he proceeds with an abbreviated, you know, Luke actually gives us an abbreviated version of what Peter said on this occasion. I have no doubt in my mind that he spoke for rather longer than just this short couple of paragraphs that we have here. And we don't know how far Peter got into his message before something happened. While Peter, verse 44, spoke these words, the Holy Spirit fell on all them that heard the word. All of a sudden, here they are, he's speaking away, and the Holy Spirit falls on these people. Apparently, they even spoke in tongues. I do not know what other outward manifestation there was of the Holy Spirit coming upon these people. I don't know if there's a rushing mighty wind. I don't know if there were tongues of fire in the room. We do know that they spoke in tongues, but there were outward manifestations. Why do you suppose that was true in this case and not true in many other cases later on as Gentiles would get the gospel? Take a look. Verse 45. They of the circumcision who believed that had come with Peter were astonished, because the Gentiles upon the Gentiles was also poured out the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now think about this for a moment. If Peter had been on his housetop and had a vision that gave him just simply the complete statement and instructions that the gospel was to go to Gentiles, you know, go to these people, gird up your loins, get a boat, go to the Gentiles, the nations, and preach the gospel out there, baptize these people, get on with it. And he'd taken that message to they who were of the circumcision who had believed in Jerusalem. How would it have been accepted? They had a lot of trouble with this later anyhow, you know, even after a lot of stuff had gone on. They had a lot of trouble making this particular transition. And I was thinking about this morning, and it came to me that whenever we do our Sabbath school or YEA classes, that one of the things that teachers have learned is that the learning cycle is not complete until something has actually been acted out. Now, you actually need to do something in order for it to come to fruition. That what is going on here with Peter is the teaching of a lesson, first of all by instruction, and this is the activity set part of it that he had to carry out in order to drive home the lesson, make the demonstration so that the people who are with him are seeing it, so there were witnesses to what had happened, that the power of God had said the Gentiles were to hear the gospel. It would not have been accepted. In fact, it still wasn't accepted by many people. But it would have hardly been accepted by anybody if it hadn't been for the object lesson that came along. They heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. And then answered Peter, "Can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit like we have?" Why did he say that? Well, because there were plenty of people who would have, who would have said, "No, you can't do that. That shouldn't happen. These people should not receive the Holy Spirit or should not be baptized." He commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord, and they asked him to stay for several days, which I guess he did. Now, the Holy Spirit could have given Peter the message explicitly, but it's doubtful that the word of one man would have changed the ingrained prejudice of those of the circumcision who believed. A demonstration was called for. So the full message of the Holy Spirit only became apparent as the event played out. So that once again, the initial urging of the Holy Spirit, the initial instruction of the Holy Spirit, requires action for anything to happen beyond it. Peter doesn't go, this doesn't happen. So you have to have the leadership of the Holy Spirit, and you have to act on that leadership in order for the full message to come and become apparent. Excuse me. Getting over a bit of a cold. It's another illustration of how God seems to work. He gives a bare minimum of explicit instruction so that the lesson can be learned by the acts of the players. Now, if you can just think about your own life a little bit in that regard, the lessons are learned by the acts of the players. God is not going to lead you around by the nose. He's not going to answer all your questions. He's not going to give you, a clear, bright line down the middle of the road where you can walk. He's going to give you the basics, and you're going to have to learn the rest of it by acting things out. Now, I think what happened in Acts 16 is a little different from Peter's experience, and there's a lesson, I think, to be learned there as well. It's the reference I made at the beginning of the sermon, verse 6. When Paul and his group had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden of the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia, after they came to Mysia, they essayed to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. They were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia. Then they tried to go into Bithynia, and the Spirit wouldn't let them do it. Passing by Mysia, they came down to Troas. How did they know that? I mean, how did they know it wasn't just a cranky customs inspector? How did they know it just wasn't somebody at the border who, some soldier who got mad at them and said, you don't need any more Jews up here. They're definitely here already. And turn them back. But they were, how do we know it wasn't weather? How do we know it wasn't an earthquake? I don't know how. We just don't know, and it doesn't tell us. Anyway, a vision appeared to Paul at night when he got down to Troas. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, come over to Macedonia and help us. After he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go to Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called for us to preach the gospel to them. Now, I think this is a curious combination here of a vision along with the guidance of the Holy Spirit. First of all, the Holy Spirit closes doors without any explanation. Just can't go. Sorry. No explanation. Okay. Let's go over here. So they try to go another location. They're stopped. No explanation. The understanding comes later with the vision, and the implication is that it was only with the vision that they understood the closed doors. The whole thing, Paul says, assuredly gathering that this is what God wanted us to do at last. And that brings me to the lesson that I learned about all this that I think is very important and something I hadn't fully grappled with before. Years ago, I faced a really tough decision, and I prayed and fasted for weeks about this decision, asking for God's direction. The most common prayer I made during that period of time is, Lord, I don't know what to do. Show me what to do. Show me what to do. I ask it over so many times, God must have gotten tired of hearing, show me, show me, show me, show me. Well, I've told the story before. One day as I was praying, it became clear to me. I mean, it just hit me like a ton of bricks. It wasn't a vision. There was no voice. I just suddenly realized something that I had not realized before. What I realized was God had shown me all he was going to show me. Nothing else was coming. What he wanted from me, was a decision. After that, I could say it was easy. It really wasn't easy, but it was plain. It was straightforward, and I had no difficulty in making my decision from that point on. Now, what I didn't realize at the time was that I had really stumbled onto something. I had not merely received the answer to a particular problem, but an ongoing principle that was involved in it. And what made me think about it was a short item in a book I'm reading about church growth. The authors point out that the first important thing is to expect the leading of the Holy Spirit and ask for it. And I that makes all kinds of sense. Here we are as a church. We've agreed and we understand that church growth is a desirable thing. In fact, it's one of the objectives of the church, part of our mission statement that we should grow. If we're effective in doing what churches do, we will grow. We know that. And so these fellows say that the most important thing is to expect the leading of the Holy Spirit and to ask for it. And what could be more obvious, than that? Because we do want the Holy Spirit to lead. We want that kind of direction. We wanted opening doors for us and closing doors that we shouldn't go through, right? I mean, Paul knew that if the Holy Spirit had wanted them to go into Bithynia, they would have gone there. And so consequently, when they didn't, something was afoot. And I think that sometimes we need to be more sensitive. I think Paul was very sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit and the direction in which it might take him. Well, they say that what their point was to pray and expect the leading of the Holy Spirit. Father, I have tried to gather all the facts available, and I am still uncertain. I am asking for your leading. I am listening for your instructions. Now, I think that's really well and good. But I am beginning to suspect that you can sit and wait for instructions until hell freezes over, and you'll never get them. It's an interesting thing to consider. What these fellows said was, following such a prayer, action can be taken by faith in the confident assurance that the Holy Spirit will indeed lead you. Now, what this said to me, and it matches my own experience, is that the Holy Spirit leads when we act, when we make decisions. It doesn't do a thing if we sit there and stare at the wall. Think about it. The Holy Spirit leads when we act. It may speak to our heart in impressions that lead us to the right act, but all that speaking is useless until we act. In Peter's case, the Holy Spirit spoke explicitly, but it went nowhere until Peter acted. Now, the immediate question is going to be, how can I know, though? I mean, I've prayed and asked for God's direction. Father, I'm lost. I got a tough decision here today. I'm praying and I'm asking you for the leadership of the Holy Spirit. Okay, how can I know as I make this decision, stepping out on this thing, that it's not my own desires that I am following? And it occurred to me that the answer to this question is the answer to another of the questions that we ask all the time. One of the ways the Holy Spirit leads is to correct. To correct. We not only have to expect the leadership of the Spirit, we have to expect and be prepared for the correction of the Spirit. You're going to pray. You ask for the leadership of the Spirit. You act. And in acting, you also ask for and expect the correction of the Holy Spirit if your decision was wrong, if it went the wrong way. Now, considering what Paul expected, Paul expected the leadership of the Spirit day by day, how else could he take his inability to go to Asia or Bithynia except the direction of the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit had sent them out. Initially from Antioch, it said, separate Paul and Barnabas for the work I've called them to. How it did, I don't know, but it did. So they did. Out go Paul and Barnabas on the work that God has called them to do. So they're moving on down the road. They make a decision, asking for God's guidance and the leadership of the Spirit. Let's go to Bithynia. And they get up that way, and the door is slammed shut in their face, and they can't go. Now, logically, Paul says to himself, if the Holy Spirit were leading us to go into Bithynia, we would be there. So he has now received a correction. A course correction. No, that's not where you're going to go. In fact, he got it twice. Tried Asia? No, that's not where you're supposed to be. Tried Bithynia? No, that's not where you're supposed to be. Now, I know what that feels like. And occasionally, you get to saying, you almost feel like sitting down the road and saying, okay, God, now where do you want me to go? You stopped me here, you stopped me there. How many more trial and error things am I going to have to go through? Of course, God would probably answer and say as many as it takes, but nevertheless. When I hearken back to my own experience in this matter, when I finally decided to act, I finally got this message through my head that God had shown me all he was going to show me. What he wanted from me was a decision. When I finally made my decision, I continued prayer and I said to God, I told him what I was doing, told him about the decision I was making, and I asked him to correct me if I was wrong. I also asked him to correct me gently because he knew and I knew that I was trying to do the right thing. And so I moved. And it is apparent in hindsight that the Holy Spirit was with me in that move and the Holy Spirit led me in that move. It was only one of many moves that the Holy Spirit has led me in my lifetime. And I only am able to really grasp them oftentimes in hindsight and looking back. And I think one of the mistakes that we oftentimes make in our lives is we really fail to acknowledge the Holy Spirit as the one that has led us where we are. We fail to be sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit. We fail to recognize the leading of the Holy Spirit. We fail to thank God for the leading of the Holy Spirit. And we also fail to be sensitive to the correction of the Holy Spirit. Looking back over the years, I can see that I intuitively did the right thing. I asked for direction, and I acted while asking for correction. And I think that is a pattern which, as I say, I stumbled on at the time. I didn't think it through. I didn't have a logic behind it. I just felt like the right thing to do. And in my own case, I don't think I have kept as good a grip on that as I might have kept. You know, that has not been as much a part of my daily life as it might have been. It's when we're in crisis oftentimes that we really give attention to these things and work the hardest on them. And it would, you know, I wonder sometimes what our lives would be like if we could follow God in that same way when we're not in crisis. Why is there any need to have to get into a crisis to have to deal with it? I do not think, frankly, that we are very expectant of the leadership of the correction of the Holy Spirit. And consequently, I don't think that we are very much in tune with it. I just think that's a part of the life. I feel that I have been led where I am by the Holy Spirit, but I have not, I think, been very aware of the hand of God when it was firmly in place and firmly guiding. And since not terribly aware, not very appreciative of it. And I know in my own case, I'll speak for me and let you speak for yourself, I don't think I've been watching for correction very much. And it's the thing that I hope in my own life I will be able to turn around. Because I really honestly believe that the movement, taking action, making decisions is crucial. At the same time, it is crucial to listen, watch for, and be sensitive to the correction when it comes. In fact, I think this last may be the most important part of the leading of the Holy Spirit, correction. One thing is clear, though. Prayer is an important part of this equation because I really think the Holy Spirit speaks to us more readily in prayer. And that's where prayer, what Peter was when the Holy Spirit spoke to him, that's where the Cornelius was when the Holy Spirit spoke to him. Now, all this leads me to some tentative conclusions. We are not led by the Holy Spirit sometimes in our lives because we have not asked for it. That should be fairly obvious. Or we ask for it and we don't receive because we don't act. We are immobilized. We aren't able, you know, we ask for the leadership of the Holy Spirit, we pray for God's guidance, and then we sit there. Whereas, in fact, you have actually got to do something for the leadership of the Holy Spirit in your life to take you anywhere. We are often, I think, not led by the Spirit because we are too tentative, because we are afraid. And there's a really fundamental thing that comes out of this that I think is profoundly encouraging. You don't have to be right all the time to please God. I really believe a lot of people go through their lives thinking that every time we make a mistake, God is really displeased with me, God is unhappy with me, I was wrong. But you don't have to be right to please God, but you do have to learn to be responsive. I don't think God thinks a thing in the world about us making mistakes. I don't think it bothers him in the least when we act and are wrong, because that gives him a chance to teach. The problem comes when we don't learn. The problem comes when we don't recognize his hand, when we don't respond to the chastisement. That's where the problem comes with God, not from making mistakes. You don't have to be right all the time. What you do have to do is to move. I think a lot of people live in dread of making a mistake, being corrected. Proverbs 3, verse 11, it's one verse, you don't need to turn to it. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord. Don't be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects like a father the son in whom he delights. Correction is a part of a Christian's way of life. And it comes all the time. Our problem is we're not sensitive to it. We're not listening for it. We're not responsive to it. And that's a lesson we've all got to learn. You know, one really interesting thing about this, because you read this, and you think, well, God's going to chastise me from time to time, and you sit and dread, you know, God's chastisement. You dread being wrong because you're afraid God will chastise you or correct you in some way. But, you know, the correction of God can be as gentle as Paul's failed attempt to go into Asia and Bithynia. You pray, Father in heaven, search my heart. Look me over. Find out what's wrong with me. Straighten me out. Help me to go the right way. Yeah, sometimes it's painful, but you know, a lot of the time it's not. It's not if we can be sensitive to it early. If you listen to it the first time. And it's like with a child. If the child hears and responds the first time, to its mistake, you got one set of problems. If it will not listen and repeats the mistake, you got a different kind of problem. Well, that's the way God looks at us. If we are responsive for the first time correction comes, there's nothing to it. But it's after a period of time of being unresponsive that God decides it looks like pain is going to be required for this to take effect. And I think that's the way some of us live our lives. We keep chugging on down the road until the pain sets in, and only when the pain sets in do we stop and go back and ask. It's an interesting question. Have you ever wondered why prayer is necessary? Now, I know it sounds like a silly question at first, but you think about that for a minute. You know, why do I need to pray about this? God knows I need it already. I mean, here's somebody in our church that's sick. God knows she's sick. She's been anointed. I don't need to pray about that. Why do we need to pray about things like that? Doesn't God already know? And I read something somewhere recently. I think it was C.S. Lewis. I think C.S. Lewis was citing somebody else. I don't know where it came from exactly, but the statement was really interesting. He said, the reason for prayer in general and intercessory prayer in particular is that God has granted to his creatures the dignity of causality. Awkward way of putting it. He's given us the dignity of making an effect, of changing things. It's an incredible gift. In other words, he sits up in heaven, he knows what's right, he can pull all the strings, put everything in the right place. Don't worry about it, don't worry about prayer, I'll take care of it. No, no, no. He has given to us the dignity of making a difference in the world. That's why why prayer makes a difference. That's why intercessory prayer is important. That's why it's important that we pray for one another, because that is a gift that God has given us that sets us apart from the other creatures. We have a dignity, a godlike quality of being able to intervene with, intercede with God to make a difference in the lives of other people. It's an astonishing thing to think about. And this, I think, is why the Holy Spirit leads and does not drive. It is to give us the dignity of making choices, making decisions, learning from our lessons, living our lives, becoming more like God. It is a part of the process of growth, spiritual growth, of heading on toward the kingdom of God. That's why God doesn't do it all for us ahead of time, right? We've got to learn. I think it's an interesting concept and really, really important. Everyone knows that there are usually several ways to get anything done. We used to have a saying in the Navy that there were three ways to do anything: the right way, the wrong way, and the Navy way. You know, this was the way. And the fact is, there really are lots of different ways to do things. I suppose there are other ways to tie your shoes than a bow knot. In fact, I'm quite certain there are. You do a granny. You do a hard knot. You know, I suppose a square knot to tie your shoes. But at the same time, all of us who are adults know that the next best thing to loafers is a bow knot, because all you got is pulling the end of the thing. If you tied it right, it'll come undone, right? So we all use bow knots. Now, a wise parent, and God is a wise parent, realizes that inventiveness in a child is encouraged by allowing the child to find his own way of doing things from time to time. You can't just show them everything. You can show them, but again, lots of times a kid is going to want to try something. If it isn't going to kill him, it's probably better for you to let him try it and let him learn. In the process, one of the things children will learn in the process is that dad had a pretty good idea. After all, next time I may pay a little more attention. There's a chance of that, not a real good chance of it, but nevertheless, he might do it. But it's how we learn. If all there is to life is doing as we're told, we will never mature and we will never come to be what God wants us to be. Now, I want you to take a look at an old familiar scripture in a new light. It's Romans 8, starting in verse 22. We know, Paul says, that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. Not only they, but ourselves also who have the first fruits of the Spirit. We also groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. What a man sees, why does he hope for it? In other words, the whole thing isn't just presented to us. No, no. We are only given the least idea, in a way, of what's out there, and then we are left to hope for it. But if we hope for what we don't see, then we with patience wait for it. Likewise, the Spirit helps our infirmities. We don't even know how we should pray, but the Spirit makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. And he that searches the hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. He that searches the hearts. God that can look at your heart, put the searchlight down in it, can go to the deepest, most part of you and know what makes you tick. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, who are the called according to his purpose. As I said, there are many ways to do anything. And God is quite capable of making any of them work. Think about it. Here you are, faced with a difficult decision in your life. You may have three roads ahead of you and choose. You don't know which one of these roads to choose. Now God, from his point of view, knows which one of them is best, which one of them is easiest, which one of them will be the hardest, which one you will learn the most, which one will be, you know, slide through pretty easy. And he could tell you which way to go on any one occasion. He could have it, you know, you could pray about it. The Holy Spirit could come along and whisper in your ear and say, take the left road, take the center road, take the right road. But it doesn't do that. He allows you to make the choice of which one you want, and then everything that happens down that road, he says, will work for your ultimate good. It's an interesting promise, isn't it? An interesting thing. It doesn't mean it won't be painful. It doesn't mean you won't have to have lessons. It doesn't mean you won't go the wrong way and have to retrace your steps. The simple point is, God isn't going to leave working with you because you made one choice or the other. They are choices you have to make, and then God will come along and work with you down the road on every one of them. And this is why what I've said before about the leadership of the Holy Spirit and the importance of correction as a part of the leadership of the Holy Spirit is to help us understand what's actually going on down the road. And I think when we understand this, it's the one way of really coming to understand the following section in Romans 8 on predestination. I think it's the way this should be understood. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Whom he did predestinate, them he called. Whom he called, he justified. Whom he justified, he glorified. What shall we say about these things? Well, if God is for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, is he not going to give us everything? What is he saying here? He is saying you're going to face all kinds of choices, and whichever choice you make, God will work with you in that choice. The Spirit will lead you in making the choice. The Spirit will lead you in correcting the choice. The Spirit will lead you in the subsequent choices that you have to face because you made the first choice. There are every day, in every way, we face choices and choices and decisions, and we want and need the leadership of the Spirit of God down through every one of those. So, when we ask for it, and when we act, when we put our lives on the line, we make ourselves available to God for correction, for instruction, for reproof, for making us into a being that is more and more, every day, like him. We have complete freedom to direct our lives, to choose which way to go at every turn in the road. Some of these choices are going to be wrong, and some of them are going to cause us pain. But God is big enough to make them work for our good in the end. And the reason for this is he is creating in us something that is much greater than we can presently appreciate. So what am I driving at? What I'm driving at is this: that the leadership of the Holy Spirit is available to us every day, every hour of the day, every decision that we make, and every way that we go. But in order for the Spirit to lead, you have to move. You have to walk. You have to act. And in order for the Spirit to lead you day by day, You have to be expecting the leadership, watching for the correction, responsive for the correction. And the kind of difference that this can make in your life, well, God alone can ultimately show us.